I'm not going to even tell you what a yoke is just yet, but I want you to know that the yoke can be broken through the anointing, amen?
Amen?
And so as we move forward, that's what I wanted to point out to you. The yoke can be broken through the anointing. But in order to preach the passage that I'm going to preach, we're going to have to learn some stuff this morning. So I hope y'all are ready to dig in, because we're about to learn. I want to talk to you a little bit about a narrative story. And in a narrative, there's always characters. There's characters in the midst of the story, and so we have to familiarize ourselves a little bit with the characters of this story. The first character I want to talk to you about is the northern kingdom of Israel. In other words, a people group known as Israel. Now listen, in order to do that, we have to go through some information. God called a man named Abraham out before there was ever a nation called Israel. And in Egypt, they became a great people. And then they came out of the exodus of Egypt. And then finally, God gave them a king. Amen. And then at some point in time, David's son Solomon sinned against God. Many of you are familiar with this story. And because of Solomon's sin, the kingdom of Israel was split in two. If you never knew that before, I was a Christian for 12 years and didn't know, the kingdom of Israel was split in two. It was split in the northern kingdom, and it was split into the southern kingdom. The northern kingdom was called Israel. The southern kingdom was called Judah. The northern kingdom consisted of 10 tribes. The southern kingdom consisted of 2 tribes. That's not a 12, that's a 2. And I want to also point out to you, because we're going to read some passages of the scripture, that many times the name Ephraim, do you know what Ephraim is? It's a tribe. It's one of the tribes of Israel. And it was one of the names of Jacob's boys. You understand that? Listen to me, chronology matters, because if you don't know where you're in the Bible, you're all discombobulated, all right? Abraham had a son named Isaac. Isaac had a son named Jacob. Jacob had 12 sons who became the 12 tribes of Israel. So what I want you to see is that we're talking 2000 BC, Abraham had all these boys, and now the nation doesn't come into existence for really over another 1,000 of years. You understand the time lapse that's taking place. And so what started off as 12 boys has now become a mighty nation made up of 12 tribes, and now the nation is split in two, and 10 of the tribes are at the top, and 2 of them are at the bottom. And many times the word Ephraim, which was one of the children of Jacob, refers to the whole northern kingdom. Does that make sense? So the whole northern kingdom sometimes was just called Ephraim. And in the capital of Ephraim was Samaria. Okay, I'm trying to get some teaching out the way before we get started with the story, all right? And the lower portion of the kingdom was from the tribe of Judah. Now, what's important about Judah? Anybody going to take a chance at it and stab at it? The most important thing that you can ever know. Come on, tell me. It's where Jesus came from. It's the tribe where Jesus came from. It's the tribe where King David came from. It's the promise that there's hope for hurting humanity. Amen? God's got a plan, and it's going to come through the tribe of Judah. And not just through the tribe of Judah, but from the house of David. God's going to give us a Messiah, the anointed one, the one that's going to fill the hole in your heart if you let him in. Amen? And so that's what Judah's all about. Well, whenever the kingdom split, these people up here in the northern portion, they start worshiping false gods. They're following after the kings that are sending them towards the world. See, there's still a mixture going on in the modern church today. We're about to get into it. The Lord spoke to me while I was on this altar, and he showed me what he wanted me to say this morning. All right? And so I want you to know that we're going to make a connection in a moment, that the same thing that was happening then is still happening today. We need to cross the bridge. We need to be able to move from the ancient times into the modern times. But the word of God never changes, and the God we serve never changes, and his principles remain the same. He wants us to stay focused on him and to keep our eyes on him and to hold on to him and his ways and not let the world begin to cause blindness and confusion in the midst of our life.
Amen.
And so I want you to know that there was a capital in Samaria and there was a capital in Jerusalem. Jerusalem was that walled city, man. We've been preaching some stuff since we started here last Christmas. And you would have been with us from the beginning, I know you would have learned some things.
Amen.
Jerusalem was a walled city, hallelujah, that had a temple in it. Anybody know about the temple? And inside that temple, there was a place called the Holy of Holies.
Yeah.
And inside the Holy of Holies, there was a thing called the Ark of the Covenant. And on top of the Ark of the Covenant, there was a cover called the Mercy Seat. And upon that mercy seat, once a year on the Day of Atonement, blood was applied. And because the blood was applied, the presence of God was able to dwell with Israel right there between those two cherubim that sat on top of the mercy seat that covered that ark. God said, that's where my presence will dwell with my people, between the cherubim, because the blood has been applied. What does that represent? It represents the cross of Jesus Christ. Amen. If it wouldn't be for the sacrifice of the eternal Lamb of God, God's presence cannot dwell with his people. You got to understand that. You got to get it in your heart. You need the presence of God to show up in the midst of your life, because you got a yoke in your life. You got a burden that lays upon your back, and you need the Lord to rid it for you. And the only way that the yoke will ever be broken is if the presence of the Lord shows up in the midst of your life. And the only way that the presence will ever show up is if the blood of the Lamb is slain and it's applied to the right spot. It needs to be applied to your heart. Amen. And your eyes never, ever vigilant must stay upon the sacrifice of Jesus, because it's not the works of your own hands. It's not the works of your own plans. It's the work of God. Hallelujah. Amen. And that alone will allow the Holy Ghost to show up in the midst of your circumstances. And so there we are, the Northern Kingdom, and they represent the modern church movement today. That's what the Lord showed me. The modern church movement, that they've aligned themselves with the world. See, there's that which calls itself the church today. They call themselves the people of God. But in this modern church, they've really aligned themselves with the world. And they've connected themselves to the ways of the world. And they've allowed the world to come in. Listen to me, the danger is that it can happen to everybody. It can happen to us if we're not careful. Mm-hmm. When nobody's immune to this. This thing is slippery, it's deceptive. The enemy of your soul, he's so slick, he's so deceiving. You got to keep your eyes open, amen. You got to ask the Lord, Lord, help our hearts that we would be able to see clearly. Amen. The Northern Kingdom Israel, I need you to know, today at some point we're going to get to it, represents a modern church movement that has aligned itself with the world. Southern Kingdom is Judah, and there are those that want to follow the ways of God, but sometimes they look to another source for help. It's not that they don't want to live for God, because see, Judah was the place that God promised Messiah would come from. It was the place that God's presence dwelled inside of that temple. But at the same time, even then, as today, many times God's people, instead of looking to what God's plan is, tend to look to other things. Just like that poor girl that was walking down the street. She didn't even know any better, but she keeps looking to another man, and he keeps leaving her empty. More characters in the story is the fact that, and I'm going to show you a map in a second, is that I'm about to step outside the camera, but there's an alliance that's taking place. Aram is another name for Syria. The king of Syria's name was Rezin. And then there's another king right here, the son of Remaliah. He was the king of Israel at the time. Israel and Syria made an alliance, and that's what I was trying to say. The modern church is allied with the world. Syria representing the world, Israel, the northern ten kingdoms, connected together with Syria, represents an alliance of the people of God, if you will. I called it the church, the people of God, Israel, with the world. They call themselves the church, but the reality of it is what I'm going to show you this morning is that it's slippery and it's slick. But and they don't even, most of them don't even know that they're being deceived. I'm telling you, there's a spirit of entertainment in the church. There's a spirit of all these things that are going on, and everything's got to be cool and groovy, or else we ain't going. Because you know what? You're outdated, bro. Well, let me tell you what's not outdated, is that if you got a yoke in your life and you need the anointing to show up, amen, that there's only one way it's going to happen. And when the Holy Spirit shows up, you're going to know that God showed up and he broke something in the midst of your circumstances. The other thing is this is Syria. The enemy and his kingdom desire to dominate and destroy everything and everyone. So I need you to understand that there's also another enemy in this story, another part of the world, Assyria, and it's in the story. And listen, he's going to come through and he just wants to rip everything apart. And that's really what the enemy of your soul wants to do. He wants to destroy everything. Lastly, there's the prophet of God, Isaiah. Amen? And so here's another map. And I just want you to see that here is the kingdom of Judah, which is the southern portion. And here's the kingdom of Israel. Here's Syria. And I just wanted to show you that there's an alliance between the two. This is where that king Rezin is from. And he's allied himself with this king of Israel. And also, there's this area here, which is the area of Judah. And in the next slide that I have, I pointed an arrow from Assyria to Judah, because part of the story has the king of Assyria trying to take over Jerusalem. All right? Now, God's going to allow them to destroy. Part of what we're talking about is that God's going to allow Assyria to take Israel. In 722 B.C., in 760 B.C., the prophet Isaiah prophesied that Assyria was going to take over the northern kingdom of Israel, and it happened in 722 B.C., all right? And so I'm just trying to give you a little bit of a picture of some things that are going on behind the scenes. But now we're going to read some scripture out of Isaiah chapter 7. And the first thing that I want you to see is this. Let's just go ahead and start reading and just try to point out some things as we go. Isaiah chapter 7, verses 1 through 14. Now, I do want to also point out that when Isaiah prophesied, if you go back to the first chapter of Isaiah, actually, you don't have to turn there. You just stay where you are, and I'm going to read something to you real quick. It says, the vision of Isaiah, this is Isaiah chapter 1, verse 1. The vision of Isaiah, the son of Amoz, which he saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. So Isaiah was a prophet to the lower portion of the country. Does that make sense? It's going to be important that you understand these things, because when I get into the meat of what I'm trying to tell you, there's a purpose for that. So Isaiah is a prophet to the lower portion of the nation, which is Judah and the city of Jerusalem, right? There were also prophets that lied most of the time in the northern portion, and they're still lying prophets today. They're on TV. You can do what you want with that. I'm telling you right now, they're on TV and they're lying. And, oh, touch not mine anointed. We ain't even got close to that, because they're not anointed by the Lord, because they're speaking lies. And it's a diluted gospel, and it sends the people into a place where they're confused and they cannot see the truth, because nobody's preaching the real Jesus anymore. And so the real anointing isn't showing up and isn't breaking the yoke in people's lives. Nevertheless, Isaiah is a prophet to the lower portion, which is Judah and Jerusalem, in the days of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, kings of Judah. So I just wanted to point out to you that Isaiah's ministry lasted through four different kings, okay? All right, now we're in chapter 7. It came to pass in the days of Ahaz, which was the third king that I named, the son of Jotham, the son of Uzziah, king of Judah, that Rezin, that's that king of Syria, and Pekah, the son of Remaliah, he was the king of Israel, went up toward Jerusalem to war against it, but could not prevail against it. And so what I want you to see is that as I cross the bridge from the ancient times to the modern times, is that there's an alliance between the people that call themselves God and the world system, and that this very system is trying to come against the true move of God, which to the eyes of people many times seems small and weak. And in comparison to the big move, where everything that looks like it glitters is gold, and everything is so appealing and attractive that people have a hard time distinguishing between the two. And what I want you to see here is that there's an alliance between the world, which is Syria, and an alliance and Israel, which are people that call themselves the people of God but aren't properly serving God, and they want to come against Jerusalem, which is the true people of God. And I need you to understand that same modern movement in the church. Let me just tell you right now. I did the research, and I know I keep on naming people's names, and y'all, some people don't like it when I do it, but I'm not trying to be ugly, but I'm going to do it. Rick Warren and his purpose-driven movement. That movement has infiltrated the church as a whole. I'm telling you, there are churches in this area that have bought in hook, line, and sinker. Let me tell you something. You do what you want. Lord, help me to have the right attitude. The Lord put it on my heart. I started buying books and giving them to leaders. Read this. The book says, deceived on purpose. There's a movement. It's like the book of Revelation says, the spirit, like frogs coming out of the dragon's mouth. Yes. Lying doctrines that are going to deceive the people. You just thought he was going to show up with a crack pipe in the end. No! He's standing behind a pulpit, and he's infiltrating hitting local churches and the preachers are buying into it, hook, line, and it's that seeker sensitive movement. We need to water it down. We need to soften it up. We need to fill up the pews because we can reach more people that way. We can reach the world that way. And I'm here to tell you that one of the things that I learned as I was studying all of that was that he said that people are not going to, there's going to be old timers. He called me an old timer. There's going to be old timers in your church that are going to oppose what you're doing. They're going to oppose the change that you're bringing in. But you just hold on. You hold on fast to this methodology that we're bringing in, and sooner or later, they're going to go. They're going to leave, and the Lord is going to send you new people. And before you know it, you will have implemented the program, and everything's going to be moving forward. Just, I've read it with my own eyes, written by their own hand, spoken by their own mouth, and that's what's happening in the modern church. There's a change that's taking place in the air. I'm here to tell you, it's not the change for the good. The prophet Jeremiah said, go back to the old paths. Go back to the old ways. The old ways is to preach the gospel. Amen. And to tell the truth. Amen. And the young people need to hear the same thing. I've heard it time and again. Oh, this preacher's relevant for young people. Let me tell you what's relevant. I'm so sick of that word. Let me tell you what's relevant. What's relevant is, it's the same blood of Jesus that saves a teenager, that saves an adult. And if you don't apply it to the doorpost of your heart, and you don't hold on to the real Jesus, you will split hell wide open. And you might sit in a church the whole time, and you might listen to a lying preacher, and you might think he was cool, and you might think he was groovy. I'm trying to bring that word back. You might think all those things, but the fact of the matter is that if he wasn't telling you the truth, you're going to find yourself in the midst of a lie.
Amen.
You're going to find out how relevant it was.
Yes.
Lord, help us. There's an alliance going on. And this alliance is trying to affect the real thing. Trying to come against the Jerusalem. Trying to come against the Judah. The real place of God. Where God's anointing rests. Because ultimately it was telling us that's where Messiah would come from. Hallelujah. And so it goes on to say, and it was told the house of David. David, Jerusalem, Judah, the lower portion. Amen. The promise. You remember that. You got that, right? Saying, Syria is confederate with Ephraim. Ephraim, the northern kingdom. Syria, the world. Confederate. They've come together. Confederate with Ephraim, and his heart was moved in the heart of his people as the trees of the wood are moved with the wind. What does that mean? Whenever the king Ahaz of the lower portion of the kingdom heard that Israel or Ephraim had made a confederation with Syria, the world, and they were coming against him, it says that he began to move, and the heart of the people began to move like trees whenever the wind blows against them. His knees started shaking. Fear gripped his heart. And I'm here to tell you that if you find yourself in the midst of a pew in a modern church where the truth of the gospel isn't being preached, when things come against your life, you also may find yourself shaking, not realizing it, but fear trying to grip your heart and convince you that God cannot work in the midst of your situation, and he cannot bring the separation and the victory that you desire. I'm here to tell you, the prophet's going to say something different. Amen?
Amen.
It says in verse 3, then said the Lord unto Isaiah, go forth now to meet Ahaz, thou and Shear-Jashub, thy son, at the end of the conduit of the upper pool in the highway of the fuller's field, and say unto him, take heed and be quiet. In other words, hey, get some peace in your life. Fear not, neither be faint-hearted, for the two tails of these smoking firebrands, for the fierce anger of Rezin with Syria and of the son of Remaliah. In other words, he's saying, calm down, quiet down. These two tails of firebrands, it's talking about the end of a fire, embers that are going out. There ain't even no fire left. It's just a little bit of smoke. You're over here flipping out and freaking out over something, and I'm here to tell you, something's about to happen to these people. They're about to be overtaken. I'm about to move on your behalf. You need to trust me in this. Sending the prophet to tell the people, trust God in the midst of all of these circumstances. Goes on to say, in verse 5, because Syria, Ephraim, and the son of Remaliah, Syria is the world, Ephraim is the northern kingdom, the son of Remaliah is the king of the northern kingdom, have taken evil counsel against thee, saying, let us go up against Judah, which is God's people, and vex, and let us make a breach therein for us, and set a king in the midst of it, even the son of Tabeel. So basically what's happening is the very thing I told you. Just like in the modern church, we're going to infiltrate. There's one movement in the church that's going to infiltrate and try to ruin the rest of the church. Most of the people that are behind that movement, they don't know any better. I'm just going to be honest with you. They're just moving along with the crowd, and they don't realize what they're doing. But I'm telling you, there's people at the top, and I'm telling you that at the top of this situation, mm-hmm. that there's demon spirits that are behind mm-hmm. to change the gospel of Jesus Christ mm-hmm. and to cause people to become confused and deceived. Are we in the last days?
Yes. Yes.
What do you think it was going to look like? I didn't think it was going to look like this, but this is it. And he goes on to say, thus saith the Lord God, verse 7, it shall not stand, neither shall it come to pass. In other words, their plans are not going to win. Jesus said to Peter, he said, upon this rock, what rock? The fact that you said I am the Son of the living God, I will build my church and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. The enemy may have a plan to try to infiltrate the true church, but I'm here to tell you that the enemy's plan is not going to prevail, amen, that there's going to be a remnant, hallelujah, that will hold on to the truth. And I just want to encourage you and ask you to encourage me that we stay part of that remnant, amen?
Amen.
Says in verse 8, for the head of Syria is Damascus, that was the capital of Syria, and the head of Damascus is Rezin, that was the king of Syria. And within 65 years, what is that? That's 65 years, shall Ephraim, that's the northern kingdom, be broken that it be not a people. Prophesying the day that Assyria would take them into bondage. And it says right here, and the head of Ephraim and Samaria, and verse 10, moreover, the Lord spoke again unto Ahaz, saying, ask thee a sign of the Lord thy God. Ask it either in the depth or in the height above. So basically what the Lord's telling Isaiah is, you tell King Ahaz to ask a sign of me because I'm going to give it to him. I want him to believe me. I want him to believe that even though he's shaking like a tree in the midst of the wind and fear's trying to grip his heart and he feels like there's no hope on the horizon, I want him to ask a sign of me because I want to show him that I'm going to be here for him. But this is the response that he gave. He says, verse 12, but Ahaz said, I will not ask, neither will I tempt the Lord. And he said, hear ye now, O house of David, is it a small thing for you to weary men, but will you weary my God also? Verse 14, therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Amen. In other words, I wanted you to ask me of a sign, but you don't. You're in so much fear right now, you can't even trust me enough to listen to the voice that I'm trying to speak to you. So because you won't ask me of a sign, I'm here to tell you I'm going to give you a sign. And this is the sign I'm going to give you, verse 14. Therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son and shall call his name Emmanuel. Now I want to turn with you. You don't have to turn with me, but I'm going to turn real quick to Matthew chapter 1, verse 23. It says in Matthew chapter 1, verse 23, about this Emmanuel. Amen. It talks about this. Now we're talking thousands of years later. It says, behold, a virgin shall be with child and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us. So what I need you to understand is that 760 years before Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us, ever showed up, God prophesied to this King Ahaz that the sign that he was going to give was that there was going to be a virgin. And they understood, what they understood was that the connection to the Messiah, the connection to the hope that God's presence was going to be with them. Amen? And so basically what he's telling them is that when you feel the heat coming on you, and listen, I want to tell you the same thing. No matter what you're going through, no matter what you find yourself in the midst of, and you need God to show up in your life, what you need to understand is that God has a plan. He sent Emmanuel, God with us, and what you need and what I need is God's presence in the midst of our circumstances. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Now let's turn to Isaiah chapter 10 real quick. And after we read all this, then we're going to actually preach. Amen? It says right here in chapter 10, now God is speaking through the prophet, and he's talking about the Assyrian. He's talking about the king of Assyria. And what he says about the king of Assyria is that he, in verse 5, chapter 10, verse 5, he says, O Assyrian, the rod of my anger, the staff in their hand is mine indignation. What is a rod? It's a form of judgment. So basically, God's saying he's going to use the king of Assyria as judgment. See, sometimes God allows things in our life to bring correction to our lives. And in this passage of Scripture, God is going to allow the Assyrian king to bring judgment both to Israel and in a way also to the southern kingdom. God doesn't want bad things to happen to you. You got to understand that. But because we live on a fallen earth, bad things do happen to us. But God is so awesome, according to Romans chapter 8, verse 28, he causes all things to work together for good to those that love him. So no matter what you find yourself in the midst of, you need to understand that God is in control. Amen? And sometimes you might find yourself under some chastisement from the Lord, but yet he wants to use that to turn you back to him. Amen? And so it says right here, verse 6, I will send him, talking about the Assyrian, against a hypocritical nation. And against the people of my wrath will I give him a charge to take the spoil and to take the prey and to tread them down like the mire of the streets. Howbeit, he meaneth not so, neither does his heart think so, but it is in his heart to destroy and cut off nations, not a few. In other words, the Assyrian basically wants to take over the world. He's actually a type of the Antichrist. And in the end, when it's all said and done, God will also use the anointing to break the yoke of the Antichrist that's trying to come against his people Israel. But right now, this Assyrian is going to try to take over all, both Israel and also Judah. But God's about to step in. Amen? It says how, in verse 9, this is Assyria talking in verse 8. For he says, are not my princes altogether kings? In other words, other countries have princes, but my princes are kings. You hear the pride in his voice? Is not Calno and Carchemish, is not Hamath and Arpad, is not Samaria as Damascus. In other words, he's saying, I've already conquered all these places. I'm a powerful, powerful king. As my hand has found the kingdoms of the idols and whose graven images did excel them of Jerusalem and Samaria. In other words, how in the world is their God going to save them whenever these other countries' gods couldn't save them? I'm the king that has the power here. Shall I not also have done unto Samaria and her idols, so do to Jerusalem and her idols? In other words, I'll destroy the northern kingdom, and I'm about to destroy the lower kingdom. Wherefore it shall come to pass that when the Lord has performed his whole work upon Mount Zion and on Jerusalem, I will punish the fruit of the stout heart of the king of Assyria and the glory of his high looks. God's saying the king of Assyria thinks that he's in control. He thinks he's the powerful one. But when the time is right, I am going to break his back and I'm going to break his power over my people's lives. Amen?
Amen.
Goes on to say, for he saith, verse 13, by the strength of my hand I have done it, and by my wisdom, for I am prudent, and I have removed the bounds of the people, and have robbed their treasures, and have put down the inhabitants like a valiant man. Verse 15. Then the Lord says this. He says, shall the axe boast itself against him that hews therewith? Hewing means to chop at wood, right? Or shall the saw magnify itself against him that shaketh it? In other words, as the saw's going back and forth, you've seen that before, those long saws, they kind of shake a little bit. As the rod should shake itself against them that lift it up, or as its staff would against itself as if it were no wood. In other words, what God is trying to say is this, is that is the axe going to talk back to the hand that holds it? Is the saw going to talk back to the hand that holds it? God's saying, I'm using this king as a tool to accomplish something in the people's lives, amen, that belong to me. I'm using this king as a tool to accomplish something upon this world that I spoke into existence with my own words. And he's going to sit here and puff himself up and think that he's something special. I will bring his power to an end like that. God wants you and I to know that the enemy of your soul, he wants to destroy you. Sometimes God allows trials and tribulations in your life, and sometimes the enemy thinks he has you, but I'm here to tell you that when the Lord speaks and says something different, God's going to break down his prideful heart, and in a moment of time, when you think that everything is lost, and you think that there's no hope, and you think there's no help, I'm telling you right now, God will show up, and he'll break the heart and the pride of the enemy in your life, and he will prove himself to you.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord. In verses 19 through 20, it says remnant four times. What's a remnant? It's a small group of people that really hold on to the truth. Everything that calls itself Israel isn't Israel, and everything that calls itself church isn't church. Hold on and be part of the remnant, church. Amen? Amen. Goes on to say in verse 24, therefore thus says the Lord God of hosts, O my people that dwell in Zion, that's another name for Jerusalem, be not afraid of the Assyrian. He shall smite thee with a rod, in other words, judgment, and shall lift up his staff against thee after the manner of Egypt. For yet a little while, and the indignation shall cease in my anger in the destruction. Verse 26. And the Lord of hosts shall stir up a scourge for him according to the slaughter of Midian at the rock of Oreb, and as the rod was upon the sea. And it shall come to pass in that day, hold on a second, shall come to pass in that day that his burden shall be taken away from off your shoulder and his yoke from off your neck, and the yoke shall be destroyed because of the anointing. Now what I want you to understand is that this prophecy is speaking of a time frame in 2 Kings chapter 19 when Ahaz is no longer king and Hezekiah now is king. The children of Judah are inside the city of Jerusalem, and the king of Assyria named Sennacherib is on the outside, and he has them stuck in there, and he's breathing threats of slaughter to them. Well, what happened was that the king, Hezekiah, said, hey, go ahead and put a burden on me. I'll give you whatever you want. The Bible says he started taking the gold doorknobs off of the temple and giving them to the enemy. I'm here to tell you that the enemy, if you give him just a little bit, he's not going to stop. And whenever he saw a little bit of weakness, the next thing you know, he sent the whole army over there and he started speaking to him. He said, oh, you think it's bad now? I'm going to tell you what the King James said. You're going to start drinking your own piss is what it says. In other words, that's old King James language, Lord. You're about to drink your own urine. You're going to be stuck in the midst inside of this city, and there's not even going to be any water for you, because I'm going to hold you down in bondage. And that's what the enemy wants to do to you. He Amen. Wants you to just give a little bit. Amen. And then he's going to take it all from you. And he's going to hold you in bondage. I'm here to tell you, don't give him a little bit. Hold on to the truth. Hold on to Jesus. Amen. There's salvation on the way. And the next thing you know, he said right here in verse 26, the Lord of hosts shall stir up a scourge for him according to the slaughter of Midian. Now, you got to know the story of Midian. He's talking about Gideon. The same thing, bondage. It said every year at harvest time, the Midianites in the book of Judges would show up into Israel's camp, and then they had so many camels, they would just destroy everything. Their camels would eat all of the grass. Their cattle would begin to be famished and die. And the Bible says that Gideon was hiding in a wine press trying to thresh wheat. Now, you're not supposed to thresh wheat in a wine press. You're supposed to stone grapes in a wine press. But Gideon is over there threshing wheat in a wine press because he's in fear. Because the enemy of his soul has got him gripped. He's not even willing to open his mouth. He's not even willing to live for the Lord. But the Lord said, get up, you mighty man of valor. Get up out of that wine press. And I need you to reestablish the altar, which is the cross. You need to put your eyes back on the sacrifice so that the presence of God can show up. And in that night, whenever the Lord led him, God showed up and told him, I want you to put a light in a clay pot, and I want you to break it, and I want you to blow the trumpet. And when they did that, all of a sudden the presence of the Lord showed up in the camp and caused confusion in the enemy's mind. They turned their swords on one another, and they began to kill each other. And in this story right here, God's saying, just as I did in the days of the judges, over there, just as I did in the days of the judges, when my presence showed up in the midst of that camp and caused confusion in the enemy's life, I'm going to do the same thing now, and I'm about to show up in the midst of your life. And if you go back to 2 Kings, I'm not going to turn there, chapter 19, verse 35, what happened was that one morning they woke up. They're all in the inside. We're back to the story of Hezekiah now. They're all in the city of Jerusalem. They're hiding in the walls. They don't really want to drink urine, and they're hoping that the Lord's going to show up in the midst of their circumstances. And all of a sudden, one morning they wake up. The Bible says, I think it was 145,000 of the Assyrians are just dead. The angel of the Lord, the presence of God showed up. And when they woke up the next morning, it's just 144,000 of them, 145,000, they're dead. They're just laying there dead on the ground. There's no answer for before it. And whenever the king saw that, it says that he went back to his home in Assyria, and a couple of days later, his own sons killed him while he was worshiping his false god in the temple. The point to the matter is this, is that God said, just when you thought there was no hope, just when you thought there was no help, the presence of the Lord showed up, hallelujah, and he broke the back of the enemy in the midst of your life. And then he goes on to say right here, I'm about to start preaching. Verse 27, it came, shall come to pass in that day that his burden, the enemy of your soul, shall be taken away from off your shoulder and his yoke from off your neck, and the yoke shall be destroyed because of the anointing. Mm-hmm. So what is a yoke? Well, a yoke is a piece of ancient farming tool. It's not an egg yolk. It's an ancient farming tool that would hook two beasts of burden together. I put that picture just because so you can see about the size of it next to this woman. And that's what you would do. You would lay it upon their backs. But you see the picture right there? You see anything in their faces? They just look so weary. They look so weary and tired. Beasts of burden. Yes. Being driven. Being driven and told what to do. It's like a yoke of slavery. It's a yoke of bondage that's on their neck. And God says that he wants to break the yoke. See, the yoke is whatever it is that keeps you up at night. The yoke is whatever it is that's been a recurring theme in your life that holds you back from being the person that God desires for you to be. Sometimes the yoke is a sin that you can't seem to shake on your own. Sometimes the yoke is a life of choices that we've made that have left us in a particular situation or circumstance, and we see the pain that's around us. Whatever it is, the yoke is painful. And the yoke, once again, it causes stress in our life. The yoke for that young lady last night was the fact that that guy after 16 years had left her. It was keeping her up at night. Tears filled up her eyes. And whatever the yoke is, the people of God want it gone. It sits on their back. It might look good at first, but after a period of time, they want it gone. And what I got to tell you is that the only way that the yoke can be broken is through the anointing. Amen? And so now we got to figure out, what is the anointing? See, Jesus said this about the yoke. He said, come unto me, ye that are labor and are heavy laden. You've been laboring? You've been working real hard to try to get the yoke off of you? He said, I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. I got to tell you something, that if you and I would learn to strap ourselves to Jesus, we can understand it here. We need a revelation here. Lord, help us here. Amen?
Amen.
I'm preaching to the preacher. Lord, help us here to gain a revelation that you are the workhorse. That you're the one that's going to bring the victory. That you're the one that's going to accomplish victory. Amen. Lord, help us to yoke ourselves to you. And we ask you, Lord God, to give us the victory in that area of our life. Now, that was just the story that I told you whenever they woke up that night. And what did I say? I said 145,000, but it was actually 185,000.
Wow.
Isaiah chapter 8. Now I'm getting into my message. But the good news is that I don't really have much to say, now that I've said the majority of what I had to say. All right. Isaiah chapter 8. It says, moreover, the Lord said unto me, so Isaiah is prophesying for Jesus, for the Lord, take thee a great roll and write in it with a man's pen concerning Mahir Shalal Hashbaz. So basically, God's telling Isaiah, I want you to get a great scroll. I want you to get a great scroll. This is a picture of Isaiah with a big old scroll. And I want you to write on this scroll some things about Mahir Shalal Hashbaz. And as you write it down, I want it to be really out in the open, and I want people to see it. That's why I need you to. Sometimes God asks the prophet to do some strange things. I want them to see the scroll. I want the people that I'm writing to see the scroll. I want it to be obvious in their mind. I want them to be, hey, what's the deal with the scroll? Oh, well, it has to do with Mahir Shalal Hashbaz. And then he says, and I took unto me faithful witnesses to record Uriah the priest, Zechariah the son of Jeberechiah, and I went unto the prophetess, and she conceived. So the idea is that Isaiah is told by God to write some things down about Mehir Shalal Hashbaz on a scroll. Then he goes into his wife, and she conceives a child. And that's his name, Mehir Shalal Hashbaz. So it's already been written down on the scroll, and then now she conceives. And the message regarding this, one of the things that I thought was interesting is that that is the longest word in the Bible. But what's more important than that is this, what it means. It means quick to the plunder, swift to the spoil. You see, part of this has to do right here where it goes on to say in verse 3, he went into the prophetess, she conceived and bare a son, then said the Lord to me, call his name Mehir Shalal Hashbaz. For before the child shall have knowledge to cry, my father, my mother, the riches of Damascus and the spoil of Samaria shall be taken away before the king of Assyria. What does that mean? It means, you remember the alliance that Syria had with Israel and was coming against Judah. God told him in chapter 7, don't be in fear, I'm going to give you a sign. So in chapter 7, we had the birth of a child. His name was Emmanuel, God with us, the presence of God. Now we have another birth of another child, and God's given some more words. Write it down on a great scroll, and the significance is the meaning of his name. Quick to the plunder, swift to the spoil. Because you see, Syria and Israel have a plan. They plan to come against you down here in the southern kingdom, but I need you to write on a scroll the name of this boy. And what I need you to understand is that before he's old enough to know who his mom and his daddy is, and actually to be able to say it out of their mouth, probably about 12 to 15 months, but in the next 15 months, I need you to understand his name, quick to the plunder, swift to the spoil, because the king of Assyria is about to take them over and bring them into captivity. You need to quit shaking in your shoes. You need to quit being like the wind that's blowing in the midst of the woods. And you need to be able to trust the Lord. I'm giving you a word. I'm going to show up, and I'm going to break the back of the enemy in your life. He goes on to say right here in verse 5, the Lord spoke also unto me again, saying, for as much as this people refuseth the waters of Shiloh, that go softly and rejoice in Rezin and Remaliah's son. Boy, there's a lot right there. You know, one of the things that's been so beautiful about being a preacher to preach this much is that as I start studying, I'm realizing all the things that I missed before. You know, I mean, how many times have I read the Bible? Quite a few, but something as simple as that, for as much as this people refuse the waters of Shiloh and that go softly and rejoice in Rezin and Remaliah's son, now therefore, behold, the Lord brings upon them the waters of the river, strong and many, even the king of Assyria and all his glory, and he shall come up over all his channels and go over all his banks. And he shall pass through Judah, he shall overflow and go over, he shall reach even unto the neck. What he's saying is this. I'm about to break down what the waters of Shiloh are for you in a moment, okay? But what I need you to know is that they're soft and they're tranquil waters. It has to do with God's eternal plan. It has to do with the house of David. It has to do with the tribe of Judah. It has to do with where Messiah would come from. But the people refused to trust in the tranquil waters of Shiloh. And instead, they put their trust, these people in the northern kingdom, in the king in the northern kingdom, the northern king that's sending them to worship false idols, and also the alliance with the world. Whenever the people of God begin to trust in something other than God's plan, then God says, if this is what you want, then this is what I will allow. And he promises them that instead of tranquil waters, he's going to allow the king of Assyria to be like a flooding water that comes over the bank and begins to cause and wreak havoc and chaos in the midst of their lives. And he says, listen to me, it's even going to come as close to your neck, Judah. It's going to come so close, it's going to overflow, but it's not going to overtake you. Amen. At least the king of Assyria is not going to overtake you. And so what I need you to understand is this, and we're about to break it down, is that this alliance between Syria, once again, and Israel, and all this time you've been probably thinking, dude, how are you going to connect Syria and Israel to the modern church and the ways of the world? I was sitting here thinking, and all of a sudden the Lord put it in my spirit, the books. I knew what he was talking about. Immediately, I went to my office, and I just moved them over here a while back. And I don't have to look very far to make my connection. Right here. These are the books that were given that I had to read whenever I went to theology school over there at a Pentecostal university. We're talking about an alliance between the world, and we're talking about an alliance between the world and the so-called people of God. And you thought we had a problem, but I'm here to tell you that this is what they're teaching the preachers in the schools where the preachers are going to school. They're not teaching them to trust in the waters of Shiloh, the tranquil waters of Shiloh that speak of Jesus. Instead, if you're gonna do some pastoral counseling, whenever somebody has problems with anger, anybody got problems with anger in here? If you got problems with anger, you come on into office and you and I are gonna talk about Albert Ellis PhD's answers for anger, okay? And one of the things that he suggests that we should do is this. Now, this is what they're teaching in the school. How you create your own anger. And so what he's going to teach is something called REBT. Now what I'm trying to tell you is that they're mixing, let me make it simple for you, they're mixing psychology with theology. They're putting the ways of the world and human wisdom connected with the Word of God. Does that make sense what I'm trying to tell you? You don't mix the world with God. You don't try to fix, oh, God didn't really address this issue right here, so we're going to help him out a little bit. No, I'm here to tell you, we just need to get back in the book, into the Word, and we need to take some time to learn that God has a plan to set the captive free. You got a yoke on your back. The anointing wants to break the yoke in the midst of your life. And so, REBT stands for Rational Emotive Behavior Therapy. What does that mean? Well, you just need to think rationally so that you can control your emotions, and it will control the reaction that you have in the midst of your behavior. So in other words, I've read the book. What this old boy would tell me is that when my 15-year-old daughter comes home pregnant for some dude that ain't gonna help out, I'm not supposed to have any rational thought like, oh, my daughter hates me so much that she went out and purposefully got pregnant and because she wants to ruin my life. That's an irrational thought. I'm supposed to think rational. She just made a mistake and everything's going to be okay. And so I taught myself that. But the problem is that even though she might have just made a mistake and she may not really hate her daddy, it doesn't change the fact that now I got this situation that I got to deal with and I feel anger boiling up on the inside of me. And you think, Mr. Ellis, that your plan is going to help to take away the pain that now I'm going to have to experience for God knows how many years that's going to take place? It doesn't work. It's garbage. Because the fact of the matter is that God wants to break the yoke. And the church is mixing these things together in the midst of teaching people instead of how to get a hold of Jesus. This is pastoral counseling right here. Solution-focused pastoral counseling. And this talks about externalizing. Well, this is whenever a couple in the church is coming in for counseling because their ADD son is having trouble in school, and mama's blaming it on daddy, and daddy's blaming it on mama. And so they're externalizing all their problems on one another. And so he's going to go through the process of explaining to them that they should not externalize and put... If all you had to do was teach them the gospel, sir. If you would have taught them the gospel, then they would have known that born of Adam, that they're selfish. I'm talking to the preacher. Born of Adam, you're full of sin. And all you're concerned about is yourself. And you look at the other person as though it's their fault. And you throw them under the bus. And you don't care about them. You're not selfless like Jesus. Jesus' spirit would say, hey, man up, sir. You made some mistakes. Stand up. Love your wife. Love your family. Take care of your children. Amen?
Amen.
But that's kind of hard. I don't want to tell people that. Then it goes on. This is one right here, and it sounds like it would be good. This is a family ministry, and this actually almost sounds good till you realize that it's not the truth. This is what they talked about the Ethiopian eunuch. The early church discovered the full meaning of Jesus' radical message in Philip's encounter with the Ethiopian eunuch. He goes on to talk about the family. This is what he says. According to the gospel, family begins with baptism. No, it doesn't. Family begins, talk about the family of God. Family begins with a radical conversion. Family in the family of God begins with a radical conversion where you are introduced, like Philip introduced the eunuch, to this Jesus that was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, and they give your heart to Jesus, and he moves in and he kills the old man, he buries him, and he allows a new man to be resurrected. Yes, and then you might go into the baptism. waters, signifying an outward symbolism of what happened inwardly. Have you given your heart to Jesus is the question this morning, because he's the one that we need to preach and to allow him to allow a radical conversion to take place on the inside of our lives.
Amen. Amen.
Helping the struggling adolescent. Talking about anxiety. Some people may be able to relate to this. Help adolescents face their anxiety. Young people, like most people, will do almost anything to avoid a direct confrontation with their anxiety. This is how we're going to help them get over their anxiety. This is what the youth pastors in modern churches are being taught to teach your young people. If they actually come in for counseling. God only knows what they're preaching from behind the pulpit. It says, neutralize some anxiety. Sometimes therapy cannot proceed until anxiety is dissipated. You need to learn how to neutralize it. Slow down. Speak in a soft voice. I know that. I probably need to practice that more. Focus on thought patterns. One of the best ways to alleviate chronic anxiety is to exercise mental willpower. So you just take authority over your anxiety. You're laughing, huh? Because you know what I'm talking about. I'm going to take authority over my anxiety. Have you ever had a panic attack, man? It doesn't make any sense. I've never had one, but I've talked to people that have. Yeah, you're going to control anxiety with the willpower of your mind when your heart's beating out of your chest and you're hyperventilating and you can't breathe and you go to the doctor or the ER and you're begging them to give you some Xanax to try to calm it down, and the next thing you know, you're hooked on Xanax and you don't know how to get off of it. But oh, if you give me Jesus and he'd show up in the midst of my circumstances, he'd break the back. You need the yoke broken in your life. You need the anointing. You need the presence of the real Jesus to show up and to do something in the midst of it. Practice positive self-talk. The first step is to stop self-statements such as, I'll never fall asleep. I know. And you know, there's some truth to that. In other words, the Lord can't show up and set you free.
Amen.
You don't have to always speak negative. Teach deep muscle relaxation. Oh, Lord, help us. This is one of the things right here that I wanted to tell you. See, there's an alliance between the world and the modern church, is what I'm trying to tell you. Israel and Syria, they're trying to infiltrate the lower kingdom, which is the real people of God, the tribe of Judah, the Messiah, the promised one, the tranquil waters of Shiloh. God wants us to learn how to drink from Messiah, from the Christ, from the anointed one, to go to him, to hope in him, to trust in him. This book right here is called The Emerging Church. Forwards by Rick Warren and Brian McLaren. I started reading about discipleship in here. The modern church says this. The emerging church says this. Discipleship is spiritual formation. I was supposed to print up something and I forgot to. Let's see. This is about spiritual formation. See, it doesn't sound bad. It sounds like you're being formed spiritually. You know, I'm not expecting you to read it. I'm just going to read it. It sounds like you're being formed spiritually. But these are some. This is a quote from this guy, Dallas Willard, who's part of this emergent church thing. Sometimes we think of spiritual formation as formation by the Holy Spirit. Once again, that's essential. So he's saying, yeah, we need the Holy Spirit to move in our life. We can't evade it. Formation by the Holy Spirit. But now I have to say something that may be challenging for you to think about. Spiritual formation is not all by the Holy Spirit. None without the Holy Spirit. But there's always more involved. And here again we run into the problems of passivity over against activity. Here lies the deepest challenge to the very idea of observant obedience to Christ in our times. We have to recognize that spiritual formation in us is something that is also done to us by those around us, by ourselves, and by activities which we voluntarily undertake. There has to be method. So he's saying that it's not going to be the Holy Spirit that does all the work. See, what I'm trying to tell you is that the gospel teaches drink from the waters of Shiloh, hold on to Jesus. The presence of God shows up and the anointing breaks the yoke. What they're saying is that that doesn't really always work like that. And so what you need to do is you need to add some other things. Now, this is what was interesting. This is from this woman here, Ruth Haley Barton, on spiritual formation. A few years ago, I began to recognize an inner chaos in my soul. No matter how much I prayed, read the Bible, and listened to good teaching, I could not calm the internal roar created by questions with no answers. I sought out a spiritual director, someone well-versed in the ways of the soul. Eventually, this wise woman said to me, "What you need is stillness and silence, and so that the sediment can settle and the water can become clear." I decided to accept this invitation to move beyond my addiction to words. She was saying teaching wasn't going to do it. The words of the Bible weren't going to do it. I sought out a spiritual director that told me I needed stillness for my soul. See, what you may not understand, but what I do realize is that there's even a campus now, a satellite campus in a local church in town. And one of the students there, who's very smart, called me up. He said, "Hey man, you ever heard of spiritual formation?" So we started talking about it. He said, "Dude, I've never heard that word before." He said, "I got to check in my spirit. It didn't feel right." So we started doing research. He did his research. I did my research. This is meditation, man. This is taking Eastern mysticism and connecting it back to the church and calling it something that people don't even know. Telling them that you need solitude and quietness for your soul. A different form of meditation. See, the meditation of Buddhism says you empty your soul, you empty yourself out so that something else can come in and fill you up. The Word of God says meditation is you take the Word of God and you put God's Word on your side.
Amen.
What I'm trying to let you know is this, is that, what I'm trying to let you know is that there's an alliance of the world along with the people that call themselves God, and then there's the true people of God who desire to walk with the Lord. And this is the waters of Shiloh. Amen. The waters of Shiloh. Let's turn real quick to 1 Kings as we close this message out. 1 Kings chapter 1, verses 33 through 34. Also known as Gihon, G-I-H-O-N, is another name for the waters of Shiloh. It says in verse 33, the king also said, this is King David speaking, he's near the end of his life. The king also said unto them, "Take with you the servants of your Lord, and cause Solomon my son to ride upon mine own mule, and bring him down to Gihon." Well, that's interesting. I never noticed that before. Solomon rode on a mule. "Bring him down to Gihon, and let Zadok the priest and Nathan the prophet anoint him there, king over Israel, and blow ye with the trumpet, and say, God save King Solomon." So what are you trying to say? I'm closing it up like this. The waters of Shiloh, the spring of Gihon, represent the house of David. This is the place where they told the offspring of David to be anointed king. Ultimately, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords was going to come from the house of David. Ultimately, he was going to come from Judah. God had told us in the passage we were previously reading, the people refuse to hold on to the king that I've set up, which is in the southern kingdom, representing Judah, and ultimately representing Jesus that would come. And instead, they're trusting in another alliance. And because of that, I'm going to allow judgment to come. I'm here to tell you that we're even in the midst of it now. That the church is so far away, most of the time, from what the true gospel is trying to say, that judgment is coming upon the church. I just want to encourage you to get back into the Word. Amen?
Amen.
Get back into the Word and hold on to the real Jesus. Be careful that you don't start drinking from another cup. Amen?